For any of you who are wondering, yes, I do know that there's a mark on the, my glasses that say what power they are. That's how I know they're the ones for reading really small print. So anyway, for those of you who don't really know me that well, I talk a lot about stories, and we already started talking about stories a little bit this morning. But I want to, I have a little different spin on how I use that than some people do. For instance, Romans 8:28 says that all things work together for them for good to those that love God and are called according to his purpose, for whom he foreknew, he predestined to be conformed to the image of his son. Now, some of you might think of that as a promise, and as I read it in the Bible, it is a promise, but for me, it's a story that I'm living into. And so when I say stories, I'm not talking about something that's false or made up. I'm talking about something that draws me into a future. Sometimes it's a good future. Sometimes I can make up stories that are not so good that draws me into a not good future. But anyway, I just say that so that you'll understand when I use the terminology a little bit. I have a friend who does an email every morning. Crazy guy. He gets up at like 3 in the morning so that he can write an email to send out every morning. Good friend of mine. And I got this one last week, and I want to read it to you, and we'll talk a little bit about it. The scripture is Isaiah 43:16-21. Thus says the Lord, who makes a way in the sea, a path in the mighty waters, who brings out chariot and horse, army and warrior. They lie down, they cannot rise, they are extinguished, quenched like a wick. Do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. I am about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I make a way in the wilderness, a river in the desert. The wild animals will honor me, the jackals and the ostriches, for I give water in the wilderness, rivers in the desert, to give drink to my chosen people, the people whom I formed for myself, so that they might declare my praises. And this is what he wrote about it. It's entitled, What Do You Do With the Past? On one hand, the experiences of our past, the fleeting moments, the long struggles, the joyous laughter, the sorrows, and all that is in between, are the containers of our identity. They collect the pieces of who we are as individuals, our communities, our societies, and as people of faith. Erase our past, and it becomes difficult to understand who we are, maybe even impossible. Like the writer of our text for the day, who reminds us in verse 16 and 17 of the goodness of God, allusions to the stories of Yahweh's powerful acts in the past, I find that I am quick to use the past as a framework for my life now. The people, the experiences, the degrees, the jobs, the homes, the families, the family history, all feel like part of who I am today. I draw strength from the riches of how things have come together to shape me and my actions. And it's all part of where I'm going in the future, right? On the other hand, I hear the text calling me to forget the past, to be open to new and magnificent things that God is doing. Forget the past? Really? I'm stumbling with that notion. I cannot hold on to the past and be open to new things of the future at the same time. And I would like to think that it's possible to ground my identity in the strength of the stories of my family and my faith tradition. But as the prophets are known to do, the author pushes me to a place of discomfort. This text gets in my way, disturbing my use of the past as a framework for moving forward. It reminds me to pay attention. It reminds me to be open to the unexpected twists and turns that just may be the signs of God's work. Now that's a lovely thought. It's really very, very encouraging, except that if you go read the actual passage, if you carry on where he left up, it says, "But my dear people, you refuse to ask for me my help. You have grown tired of me. You have not brought me lambs or burnt offerings. You have not honored me with sacrifices, though I have not burdened and wearied you with the requests for grain offerings and incense. You have not brought me fragrant incense and pleased me with the fat of sacrifice. Instead, you have burdened me with your sins and you wearied me with your faults. I alone am the one who blots out sins for your own sake, for my own sake, and will never think of them again. Let us review the situation together, and you can present your case if you have one. From the very beginning, your ancestors sinned against me. All your leaders broke the law. That's why I have discarded you, your priests, and assigned Israel a future of complete destruction and shame." Okay. Well, my friend gave an excellent example of terrible Bible study. I mean, he took it right out of context. But there's something you don't know about my friend. My friend found out he has prostate cancer. And he's taking radiation therapy right now. And the story he's living into is that God is bringing him into a new thing, that this is a part of his ministry. He's been a minister to the Lord for many, many, many years. I've known him for over 20 years. He's living into the story that this is a new part of his ministry, thinking about all the people he's going to get to meet, thinking about how God is going to use him. And that's how he stays positive in this very, very difficult time of his life. My story is a lot like that. You know, I told you about Romans 8:28 and 8:29 and how they are a story that I live into. I don't think it's by accident that you're here this morning. I don't think it's by accident that I'm here this morning. I don't think it's by accident that my friend wrote this email that I read and have been contemplating on it. I don't think it's an accident that we have a wonderful, wonderful pastor who goes and reads the background and the history of everything that's going on. And he has changed my view of many of the stories in the Bible by what he brings. It's amazing. But as we've been talking about the Holy Spirit recently, I think one of the things we really need to think about, actually, I got three questions that we need to think about. Let me read them to you. What is this book? How are we to use it? And what is the role of the Holy Spirit as we use it? And at one time when I was a Pharisee, I had specific answers with proof texts for each of these questions. But these days, I'm not quite so sure that I have an answer. It kind of depends. My friend, as he's facing something that is pretty scary to him, his answers to these have changed a little bit, I've noticed in his writing. Again, talking about stories that we live into, and my own experience with it is that there's a verse that the Lord brought alive in me, and it's in Matthew somewhere, and it goes something like this. He's speaking to the Pharisees. "How can you believe, you who seek honor from one another, and don't seek the honor that comes from only God?" Now, that's a pretty powerful verse. It's not one that most people would think of as a verse to claim for their lives, but I've claimed it for mine. As a Pharisee, as someone who knew the Bible pretty well, not a Bible student, but I knew it pretty well, had it figured out, thought I knew what everything meant in it, I found that I was studying the Bible, but I wasn't letting the Bible read me. I read the Bible, but it didn't read me. It was a thing to hold out here as a student to understand, and if I figured it out just right, then I was okay, because, you know, Christianity is all about what you believe, right? I mean, that's what I grew up with. It's the list of things you believe and the things that you know. But as the Lord was trying to show me that there was more to being a Christian than just what you believe and what you know, he said, that verse was for me. Now, I don't have it written anywhere. I didn't hear a voice, but I knew that was me. How can you believe, you who seek honor from one another, and don't seek the honor that comes from only God? This is the power of the Holy Spirit. This is what he does for me. This is my story. This is how I've experienced him, is that he takes things that, taken in context, and just lights them on fire and puts them in my face so that I see that's for you right now, taken out of context, twisted, upside down and backwards. This is where you're at. This is what you need to do. So what is this book? It can be a textbook, and it's excellent to be a textbook. We should use it as a textbook. We should study it. We should know about the background and everything that's going on. But how does the Holy Spirit interact with it? And I can tell you my experience, but I don't even know that I can explain it. I can only just tell you that when I'm in a place where I need a specific word that there may not actually be a special parable or a special passage that directly applies to my circumstance, this book reads me. And the Holy Spirit shows up, and he shows me what it is that I need, and how it is that I'm to move forward. So based on that verse, I'm not technically a Pharisee, and certainly before the Lord impressed me with that verse, I wouldn't have been eager for any of you to suggest that I might be one. But it changed my life. There have been a couple other, well, more than a couple, several others that have done the same thing. So I want to impress upon you the power of letting the Holy Spirit and this book read you. It's a place to, when you're scared, when you're alone, when you feel alone, when you don't feel like your path is clear in front of you, when something has been thrown in your way that you don't understand, and you're going, aren't you a good God? Aren't you here to bless me? Aren't you here to make me of value to the kingdom? That you can come to and you can say, Lord, I'm just going to read until you show me something. I don't know what's going on. I don't have a clue, and I need your help. And this is where I'm coming, and I'm listening to you. That's another way. Not a better way, but another way to come to this book. So anyway, short and sweet. That's what the Lord's had on my heart, and that's what I wanted to share with you. So I thank you all.